Ladies and gentlemen, we will call to order the October 4th, 2019 board meeting of the South Coast Air Quality Management District. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Do any of my colleagues have any opening comments?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just real briefly, I wanted to mention that I got a chance to go out on a trip to the Imperial Valley, meet with the Imperial Irrigation District and the Coachella Valley Water District. So, Supervisor Perez, I got my hat here. So, as we're talking about Coachella Valley for the AB 617 community for the next year, I wanted to make sure that I could get out there and learn a little bit about what's going on in the area and learn about the Salton Sea and some of the issues that are occurring out there and some of the solutions that are being attempted. So Supervisor Perez has really brought this issue to the forefront since he's joined the board, and just want to let you know that I'm sure that I speak for all of us that we want to make sure that we can make a good impact in that community. So thank you for doing that.
I appreciate you. Anyone? Excuse me, anyone else?
Supervisor Hahn has something.
Thank you. Good morning. As a part of California Clean Air Day yesterday, I participated in the press conference of the unveiling of the first ever in the world zero emission top handler at the Port of Los Angeles. And these are, top handler is the huge piece of equipment that lifts the cargo vertically. So I guess historically there was a sense that those machines would be more difficult to be zero emissions, but they unveiled two of them, and they claim that they'll be able to go through two full shifts on the docks before they have to charge up. And then when they have to charge up, it's only a couple hours to actually charge them back up. So I know both ports have this goal of reaching zero emissions by 2035, and this was very exciting to see these two pieces of very heavy machinery being unveiled yesterday. It's pilots, tests, so they're going to see if indeed they do work. But it was very exciting. Thank you.
Yes. Anyone else? Ms. Mitchell, any comments this morning?
Good morning. Traffic was terrible.
Yes.
That's not news.
Yeah, that is news. Always bad news. All right, if hearing no other comments, we will go to the consent calendar. Items 1 through 19.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
I'd like to request that we add an item to our rule and control measure forecast in number 18. This would be rule 1111, which deals with low NOx heaters. We passed a rule couple of years back that kicked in this last Tuesday, and it's having an unforeseen impact on my mountain communities, well, any mountain communities, but they happen to be in my district, over 5,000 feet of elevation. Susan and her staff were great to go up to Lake Arrowhead last night and meet with my contractors, and they really expressed their appreciation for the reassurance you gave them. They had a good experience talking with you. But nonetheless, we're in the position now where, because there's no compliant product, those contractors are going to have to get one-off approval for every installation they do for every home in those communities from Susan's staff. The manufacturers need to go to hearing board to get a variance. I would like this put on the calendar so that we are a backstop in case the manufacturers choose not to get those variances or there's some hiccup, that my residents who need heaters when it snows, for example, are able to get those. So I'd like to get that added to the calendar, please.
Does the staff have any comment as it relates to that?
So as Supervisor noted, as a backstop measure, we think that's fine. We think that we're working with the manufacturers, and let me restate that. We are working with the manufacturers and urging them to go to the hearing board. We believe that they will go to the hearing board and obtain a product variance. If they obtain that product variance, then there will not be a rule amendment necessary. So as a backstop mechanism to place it on the calendar, we think that's fine.
Thank you very much.
Sure. So we don't have a problem with that. May I get a motion on 1 through 19?
Move approval.
Second.
Nope.
Mr. Chairman, may I have a moment?
Nope, Bay has something.
Oh, yeah. Supervisor Hans, you're under arrest.
Here it is.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I'm accusing myself from agenda item number 13 because of a campaign contribution within the past 12 months from Klee, Tushin, Bogdanov, and Stern.
Okay, we have a motion and a second.
Second, Mr. Chair.
Is there any objection to a unanimous roll call with the exception of Supervisor Hahn on item 13? Hearing none, those items are carried. Items 14 through 21. May I get?
Move approval.
We have a motion. Maybe we get
Mr.
a second.
Mr. Chair, this is the clerk. I think we need a vote.
14
on 20
through 21. 21. Was that a second?
Was there something else?
Dr. Burt.
Yes.
The motion was made for numbers 1 through 19. And we need to go to 21.
It actually should have been 1 through 13. And this should be 14 through 21.
Okay.
Oh, that's right.
Okay.
Okay. Then we'll move on to 23. 23 through 29.
Move approval.
Second.
Is there any objection to your unanimous roll call on 23 through 29? Hearing none, that those items are unanimously approved. Item number 30.
Good morning, Dr. Burke, members of the board. My name is Sarah Reese. I'm an assistant deputy executive officer in planning at the district, and I'm going to give an update on where we are on facility-based mobile source measures. So just a quick summary of the board direction that was provided to us in May of 2018. We were directed to take action on 5 different facility-based measures, so on airports, ports, new and redevelopment, warehouses, and on rail yards. And the direction we were provided kind of went from more voluntary memoranda of understanding approaches down to some more regulatory approaches. So on airports, we were directed to pursue memoranda of understanding with the 5 major airports in our area to implement clean air action plans. Similarly with ports, we wanted to capitalize on the work that the ports had already done in developing a clean air action plan and to incorporate that into an MOU. On new and redevelopment, we were directed to take another look at some of the impacts on jobs, on some of the economic impacts that might result from a regulatory scheme, to study that a bit more, to work with the working group, and then come back with a recommendation. For warehouses, we were directed to start pursuing regulatory action under our indirect source authority. At the same time, we were directed to conduct an economic study to look at what impacts of such a rule could look like. And then on rail, we were also directed to pursue rulemaking and then at the same time continue to explore other agreements, other voluntary arrangements that we could make that would get emission reductions. So on airports, happy to report that the airports have been hard at work developing what they call their air quality improvement plans or their plans to get emission reductions. I point out that with airports, the bulk of the emissions are associated with aircraft, but we were specifically directed to pursue reductions for the non-aircraft emissions. And that's because there's a lot of legal issues and restrictions on emission reductions that we could get from the aircraft. However, there are still emission reductions we can get the non-aircraft from trucks, from ground handling equipment, and other types of ground equipment. So all five of our commercial airports have developed air quality improvement plans. You know, we have been working with them to develop the emission inventories to better understand and quantify what those reductions could look like and incorporate measures and reductions into MOU language. In terms of our airports for the draft MOUs, you know, the goal is that we're going to be able to get SIP creditable emission reductions from these agreements at the end of the day. We have, again, been working really hard to quantify what those emission reductions might look like. They are relatively minor because, again, the bulk of the emissions associated with airports are from aircraft, and these are for non-aircraft emissions. But still, it's, you know, it's a good sign that they're willing to work with us and get emission reductions where they can. In terms of a status update, so we have released our preliminary draft staff reports, which includes those draft air quality improvement plans as well as draft MOU language. We have a public consultation meeting scheduled for next week where we will go over this in detail and be able to take input from the public. Planning on having our fourth MOU working groups meeting coming up the following week. And then our hope is that we're able to bring something back to the board for consideration in December when the airports have gone through their ACIP and MOU process. And then the end of December, we hope to be able to submit this to CARB where we can then go through the SIP creditable process. Regarding ports, a little bit of a similar track. The ports were a bit further ahead on this as they had already developed their Clean Air Action Plan and gone through a major update in 2017 with that. And so we wanted to be able to have an MOU in place with the ports that would then take specific elements of that plan and be able to calculate and have commitments for very specific emission reductions that we could then take SIP credit. Key highlight of the Clean Air Action Plan and the Clean Truck Program is really the main piece where we're hoping to get significant emission reductions. Similarly with the ports, there's many of the emissions associated with the ports are from ocean-going vessels, and there's limited, some things you can do there, it's still limited, but there's a lot we can do with the Clean Truck Program. And so the ports are in the middle of developing that. Part of that is in turns on developing a truck rate, where a rate or a fee is imposed on trucks that aren't as clean as others, or perhaps a rebate for trucks that are cleaner. The ports are in the middle of still developing that process and what that looks like, and they've been a little delayed in their rate study that would go into inform that. But we are confident that the ports are proceeding, and you know, we believe that this will be a cornerstone of the emission reductions we're able to achieve through the cap. There are also some other measures that the port is looking at in the cap, procurement planning for for cargo handling equipment, where when leases of cargo handling equipment come up, that there's cleaner equipment that's installed, and then they have some other measures, including incentive programs, would be put in place. So right now we're waiting for the ports to complete their truck rate program and their study, and we should be getting results of that this fall. We're still working with the ports to complete our understanding of baseline emissions and to quantify emission reductions that we expect to get out of the elements of the Clean Air Action Plan. We're working on finalizing MOU language. And we're hoping that the Port of LA and Long Beach boards will be considering the adoption of the MOU in early 2020 at this point. On new and redevelopment, this facility-based measure was going on a slower track in that we were directed to take a look at regulatory action, but also still consider what economic impacts might be as a result of developing a rule. And so we had some very specific concerns from the board on job impacts, on potential impacts for housing, and similarly economic effects. So we were still continuing to meet with the working group. We did proceed with developing an RFP. It's under $75,000, so a relatively small one, but aimed at looking at what potential economic impacts would be, specifically on construction fleets, which are the bulk of the emissions associated with new development, and to evaluate what those impacts would be if you were to have a rule that, you know, required turnover of a construction fleet, for example, or had increased penetration of cleaner construction equipment. One concept we're also looking at on new and redevelopment that we're still working through with our working group is the idea of CEQA air quality mitigation programs. So an idea that you would have a project, that there's air quality impacts associated with that project, but there could be other mitigation measures associated with that, perhaps even an exchange fund program that could be put in place where we can have additional mitigation of those impacts and still proceed with the project. We're still figuring out what that might look like. Again, I mentioned this is on a slower path than some of the other facility-based measures, but that's in general the direction that we're looking at. On warehouse ISR, we've been busy at work. We've had several working group meetings since the last board update. Really looking at the indirect source rule as a mechanism to facilitate emission reductions, pulling together other programs that are in place. So we know there's a number of regulations that are already impact the trucks associated with warehouses. There's some other investments and activities we can make. And so the ISR piece, we're looking to see where that can kind of pull all of that together. And so the concept that we have, and this is very conceptual, we're still working through it with the working group, so I have ideas to present, but not a lot of details. But it's the WARE program, the Warehouse Actions and Investments to Reduce Emissions. And it's really a kind of a menu approach, similar to if you're familiar with the LEED concept for efficient buildings, where there would be a menu of actions and investments that facility operators could implement. Those actions would then be associated with specific points. And then each facility would have a certain number of points that they would have to meet each year to be able to be in this program. So, some of the concepts that we have, for example, the points that each facility operator could earn, it could be based on the number of trucks that visit that particular facility. We could have different menu items that would have certain points associated with them. We haven't done any of the calculations to see what these points would look like, how much each particular menu item would be, but, for example, there could be points for infrastructure, points for solar panels, points for, other actions that we know are ultimately associated with air quality reductions and can facilitate attracting cleaner vehicles. We're also looking at some other factors that could determine point value. For example, if a facility is located approximate to sensitive receptors or in an impacted community, perhaps there's a way that we can weight points so that there's more points associated with the reductions that take place in those particular communities or at that particular facility. So we're also looking at potentially phasing this in. So we would phase this in based on, and again, this is conceptual, but looking at size of the warehouses, phasing them in over time. Also a phase in on the number of points that the warehouses would have to earn so that the rule might increase in stringency as we go over time. But again, we still have to determine the specifics of what timing looks like for the program, what the appropriate level of stringency looks like, what particular menu items would be associated with the menu, and what those point values would be. So far, again, we've rolled out this preliminary concept to stakeholders. They seem fairly receptive to it. The community stakeholders have also expressed support for this rule concept. As you can imagine, there's a lot of questions, and I'm sure you all have a lot of questions as well. And as I said before, I don't have many answers right now because we're still in the process of working that all out. But there's also, a big question on how getting through the system, we get to SIP credit at the end of the day, which is why we're doing all of this. But we are right now on a path where we're recommending coming back to the board with a proposed rule in May of 2020, and we'll be doing multiple updates as we continue to develop this and flesh out the concept. On rail, both BNSF and Union Pacific have voluntarily prepared emission inventories and have provided those to us for all the five major rail yards in our basin. These inventories are really helpful because that gives us a much better idea of what our starting point is in terms of the emissions that are out there, and then where we need to take a look to see where we can get some reductions. We do note that there appear to be very substantial emission reductions of diesel particulate matter associated with the rail yards over the last 12 years. This is mostly from non-locomotive sources. We don't expect that we had very much in terms of NOx reduction, although for the emission inventory we've seen, we only have that emission inventory for most recent years. We don't have it for the earlier years, so it's hard to do a quantitative comparison. We're still reviewing the analysis that we have, so we're still evaluating that. But it's very helpful to have this data, and it'll help better inform both our regulatory process as well as some work that's happening with AB 617. So this is what we have kind of preliminarily in terms of the emission inventory. And these are for sort of the five big rail yards that we have. And you can see, again, as I mentioned, we've had some fairly significant emission reductions on diesel particulate over this time. So in terms of next step, I mentioned we're evaluating those emission inventories that we've received, which can help pinpoint where we should look for further reductions. We are coordinating with CARB, and so CARB is very interested also in developing either a regulation or some other actions on reducing emissions from rail. We are working to develop a joint workshop with CARB. I think it makes a lot of sense for us to coordinate closely together, not only to make sure that whatever regulations we have match up, but also in recognition that CARB has different authorities than what we have, and it makes sense to balance that out and make sense of that as much as possible. We are hoping to come back to the board with an indirect source rule on rail yards by the end of 2020. And there is also some potential that some of the concepts we're looking at on warehouses might bleed over to rail yards. And so there may be a ware-like approach that we could look for for the rail yards as well. So again, kind of a summary of where we are and what you can expect to hear back from us on airports. We'll be coming back to the board in December on the draft MOUs. On the ports, we're looking for a consideration on those MOUs in early 2020. For new and redevelopments, we've released our RFP. We're working through that process. We're hoping to get some results from that can then better inform where we head on that particular action. For warehouses, we'll be coming back to the board for consideration of an indirect source rule in May of 2020. And then on rail yards, looking at coming back to the board with our rule in December of 2020. And with that, I'll answer any questions. Thank you.
Supervisor.
Thank you. One of the concerns I had as we were moving through the MOU with the ports was what progress are we making on at-birth emissions? I felt like that was the area. I brought it up, I think, a couple times here and wondering if we're drilling down a little bit on at-birth and how the port's responding to our suggestions.
Sure. So CARB is in the middle of developing a revised at-birth regulation, and when that's in place, that will capture substantially more in terms of the number types of vessels, as well as the number of vessels that are subject to the at-birth requirements. So it's really looking at that regulation will drive a lot of those emission reductions. You know, I will say it's important with the ports to recognize.
Do we have to? We can't be more aggressive, or we can't come up with our own. I mean, if the ports are willing to enter into a memorandum of understanding with us, do we have to wait for CARB to do regulations?
I don't believe we necessarily have to wait for CARB to do regulations, but we believe that where the CARB is headed with the at-birth regulation.
Where are they headed with the at-birth regulations?
So they're already having significant coverage of it. They're increasing both the types of vessels that will be covered by it, so it's not just the container ships, but the other types of vessels,
right,
as well as having more of those vessels that either need to.
And when will those regulations come out?
They're scheduled, I believe, for next year. I have to go back and look
but
at the schedule.
But if we're looking to have the port adopt it, was it early 2020, the MOU?
So, yeah, the MOU is a commitment. The MOU would be the commitment to then proceed with specific actions within their Clean Air Action Plan that they would then implement over time.
Yeah, I guess you see where I'm coming, right? I feel like we should bake into our MOU what we, because we know the technology exists now. Joe and I have seen it out there. We know that almost every ship could be given the bonnet technology if they don't plug into shore power, that we could probably cover the majority of ships. And I just think that's something we know it exists. I'd like to see us have a stronger suggestion
stronger focus
in our
on that.
MOU as to that, because we know the ships are a huge source of pollution. in our entire basin, but particularly for the communities that we represent, San Pedro and Wilmington and North Long Beach also suffers from that. So it feels like this is an easy win for people who want to breathe clean air.
There's definitely, you're absolutely right. I mean, the ports have, or the ships at the ports, they have a massive impact, certainly on diesel particulate matter. I will say that our facility-based measures are more focused on the NOx side, but we also are cognizant that there's clearly air toxic impacts and localized impacts associated with the DPM that we're interested in.
So I guess my question is, at what point do we on the board?
You're sitting next to the chair of the ports committee.
I know, right?
Yes.
I know.
And so, you know, it would seem to me that he could move this at his warp speed if he was so inclined. So she can't do that, but
so
he
ordered.
Can't do that.
Right, second.
Now he's torn up his microphone. He's so upset.
Okay. And I guess process-wise, when would we as a board agree to our half of the MOU with the ports before we give it to them?
So they're going through that process now, but we'll be bringing this for your consideration in December.
When?
In December of this year.
December?
Yes.
And then if we agree on it, then we give it to the port?
The port is looking at it simultaneously because they have a process as well that they have to follow with their boards, but it'd be...
But I'm not going to agree. Honestly, Chairman Burke, I'm not going to agree to it on our end unless we have really significant at-birth emission reduction policy in there.
You can speak to your neighbor.
Yeah, if I may.
He agrees with me.
If I may, Mr. Chair and Supervisor Hahn. When this AQMP came before us, we said clearly that if the port and AQMD can't agree to terms, or at least the port's not moving aggressively on the MOU, we will pivot to rulemaking. At this point, I'm hearing from staff, Mr. Nastri, that they're making some significant progress, and I'm pleased to hear that. I do know in talking to Wayne, the truck rate study, we're anxious to get that study back. Can you give us an update on where we're at on that truck rate study?
Yeah, so the ports had hoped that they were going to have results earlier. They ran into some difficulties because it's a pretty complicated problem that they're trying to model, but they hope that they're going to have results of that study coming out this fall, and that will then better inform where they go with the truck rates.
Very good. And I also want to commend and recognize the technical working group that has come together and working with both staff and both ports. But, you know, in talking to and in hearing Supervisor Hahn, we represent the most impacted, disadvantaged community surrounding these ports. And it's up to us to ensure that, you know, we hold everyone accountable from AQMD to both ports as well. So we're both relentless. We've got to be aggressive. But at the same time, for me, we want to make sure that we're fair. And we represent, again, two communities that have been impacted by these emissions.
Yes.
And looking forward to continuing this discussion moving forward. Thank you.
Great. Thanks. And I just want to correct myself. I said that we would be bringing back the MOU at the December for board consideration. It's actually early 2020 because we have a little bit more process to do, but it would be very soon in 2020.
And if Mr. Nastri, do you want to, anything else we should be aware of on the ports component of the AQMP?
Well, as Dr. Reese had spoken, part of the strategy is to really try to get the Air Resources Board to focus on accelerating their rule development and then really trying to coordinate our aspects. So one of the things that we're most focused on are the heavy-duty trucks, and I would say that preliminary, what we've seen from the truck rate study, and it is preliminary, we've heard about truck rates varying anywhere from $5 to $20 per truck. What that would do would lead to a mitigation fund. That mitigation fund could be anywhere from $70 to $90 million. Is what we're expecting. That, in turn, we believe would dramatically accelerate the introduction of much cleaner trucks. So again, this is all preliminary information. We know it's not final, but we know this is the range that we've heard with regards to the truck incentive fees that could be out there. And then I would say that the challenge, again, as Dr. Reese pointed out, is trying to maximize all those other type of actions that are necessary, whether it's the cargo handling equipment, whether it's other aspects related to locomotives, on dock, all those things are things that we're looking at. And again, trying to maximize the impact by coordinating with CARB.
Thank you.
I had the pleasure of spending an evening out at the port with Councilman Buscan the other night, and I was just stunned by the way that that port has grown in my lifetime. It's just absolutely amazing, yeah. And I know it has a long way to go.
Oh,
but
yeah.
They're obviously a lot better than when we started. You know, there's no question about that.
It's not good enough yet.
Right. Right. So now, Joe, if you want me to move your seat down to the other end, I'll be glad to do that. Okay.
She's kicking me out of the table.
Yeah, no problem. Michael?
Okay, Mr. Chair. Wayne, just curious, with regard to the ports again, how will the recent legislation, SB 210 by LEVA, the Clean Trucks, Clean Air Program, which now for the first time in history will make heavy-duty diesel vehicles medium-duty over, 11,000 pounds, subject to the Bureau of Automotive Repair's inspection and maintenance program, which I deal with every day during the week for cars and pickups and all the people that try to circumvent the program by sticking a probe in a Prius when they're, you know, testing a Ford F-150 pickup. How's this going to impact them? I know in Barr, just in 2013-15, switched over from the probe where they put it in your back and had that little like treadmill they'd run the car on. Now it's done by computers. So almost every smog check is just done by a computer. You plug it into the system, the data acquisition device, and it reads it and you're done in 5 minutes. How long will this take to implement? But once they do, this is really going to help us, and maybe we can coordinate with Barr in the implementation of that inspection maintenance program. Every truck is going to have to be inspected for clean air.
Yeah, it's a very significant program, and as we've heard at various conferences, the compliance rate is actually fairly low. I mean, the non-compliance we've heard is anywhere from 30 to 60% for these heavy-duty trucks, so we believe it'll have a significant impact with regards to getting those non-compliant trucks either repaired so that they are compliant or off the road. So we think it'll have a significant impact throughout the area, especially those areas where you see a lot of goods movement. So for instance, at the ports, the good movement corridors, the warehousing areas, we think will have a tremendous improvement.
Okay. Mr. Chair, second question regarding rail yards. You know, I noticed Burlington Northern, Santa Fe, Union Pacific, but I just pulled out my trusty Metrolink book, which also has all the Amtrak trains in here every day. And it just hit me because as I was going to my city in San Dimas a few weeks ago, I got off the bus about three blocks from City Hall, and I saw a Metrolink train go by, and it kind of took off a little bit. It reminded me of as a kid watching a school bus. It's just the black diesel soot coming out of that Metrolink train in the neighborhoods. And I look here, all these trains go through Orange County, San Bernardino, Riverside, northern part of LA County gets part of Ventura. You can get lucky on this. But you know how many trains that Metrolink and Amtrak run through our four-county district a day? Can anybody guess? You talk about, and they're all diesel. 10, 20, 30, 50, 100, over that, over 150. 200-plus trains, heavy-duty diesel trains a day going through our four-county district. 200 and approximately 10 or so I counted, but it could be off a few. So if you look at the Burlington Northern, they have dozens. These are hundreds a day, Monday through Friday, then it cuts down to maybe like 100 on the weekends. But those are significant. Each one of our neighborhoods, when they stop in Anaheim, you know, or Irvine, or Baldwin Park, Claremont, Pomona, all my residents, and I was at Baldwin Park, and they were concerned. I said, what are we doing about it? I said, we've given, I know, close to $100 million to convert, but what else can we do? Are we even looking at Metrolink and Amtrak? Because they're a significant, I'm curious what their contribution is to this. We've never actually looked at it.
I thought we gave $50 million.
We did.
I thought we gave $50 million to Metrolink.
Probably more, I think.
About 20 cars.
You're correct, Dr. Burke.
You can't hear yet.
The trains are in the process of being converted over to Tier 4, and you're correct in the dollar amount.
What's the percentage of trains that are Tier 4 now, though?
There's not very many, Vice Chair. This board has awarded a substantial amount to convert their Tier 2s to Tier 4s. They're in the process of receiving those locomotives, shake down, and then put them into service.
Okay. I'd heard that very few have been converted, and I know it was over $50 million up to, we have some more, like up to 100, but is it one or two? Because I've heard people tell me when I'm on the trains, no, they're not doing it, it's taking a long time.
No, if I might, I'm on the Metrolink board, and we're working very aggressively to get the Tier 4 engines in service. However, you have to remember that the Tier 4s don't exist, and we're building them and testing them, and there's been problems with design and all of that that we've been working out. There are at least 12 to 15 engines on the system right now, and we are funded to get 40 of them, and we're working as fast as we can to get them implemented.
When do you think they'll be in place, maybe, as you say, the design problems, a couple of years, or?
It'll take another, at least a year and a half to get them on.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Mr. Chair.
What makes me wonder is what happened to our $50 million while they were working on it?
So we funded it in different phases, Dr. Burke. So we gave, I think it was in three phases total. So we've only given enough to fund a certain amount at a time. So
how much should we give them?
No, how much?
I
think it was $38 million, Dr. Burke, but we can check. I think it was $38 million, but
what was $38 million?
The total funding amount.
No, it was $50 million.
I'll have to check on that, Dr. Burke.
No, I don't have to check. I know it was $50 million. Okay. So you don't know how much we've given them?
Yes, so to date, you're right, Dr. Burke, the total amount is 50, but we've only given 38 to date.
You know, I love Larry, but I wouldn't give him $38 million if he didn't have some trains. Everybody knows I love him, okay? So I wouldn't give him $38 million if he didn't have more than three or four trains and if they were just developing them. How does that work?
So their Tier 4s were just recently developed by the manufacturers, and so as they roll out, they have to do shakedown testing, and so we've given them two different awards. They get a certain amount of trains at a time, and they phase them in, so they do the shakedown testing.
Who determined that?
I believe it's Metrolink in concert with the locomotive manufacturer.
Well, if we gave them the money, weren't we involved in this decision process?
So we made the award to Metrolink, and then we
worked with them. My question was, if we give them the money, weren't we involved in the decision process?
In the decision process?
Yeah, I don't know how you pay them the money. Yeah.
So we only pay when they deliver the locomotive.
Can you articulate it better than me, Janice?
No, you're saying exactly right.
The money is... We don't get the money until we've actually finished and turned in paperwork that says we have scrapped that old engine.
But
so
he
Dr.
says
Burke,
they're giving you $38 million. Yeah. Have you scrapped it $38 million worth of engines?
Dr. Burke, I'm sorry. We've awarded it, but we haven't paid that amount yet. Yeah. So the board has made the award.
You need to get this story straight.
Right. What have we paid them?
So Dr. Burke, what I could suggest is that
I'm not
we
talking
back.
To you, Wayne. I'm sorry. Yes?
I'd have to check with finance on how many invoices we've already paid.
Sunjata's here. Find her.
There she is.
Where is she?
Back by the light.
I can't see because this light blinds me. Sunjata, how much did they pay them?
Anyway, we've authorized a certain amount of money out of court. Carl Moyer funds for conversion over to the...
I'm not trying to take the money from you.
I understand that, but I'm just trying
million,
to say we're...
There's $50 million floating around here
somewhere.
Did I?
We're,
I
the
thought
money,
it had already been spent on these somewhere. Engines.
Money isn't at Metrolink. You've authorized that money, and we get paid when we turn in the invoices, okay?
Okay.
Good morning, Dr. Burke. The contracts are approved by our governing board, and I can find out how much has been paid, yeah. If that's what you're looking for.
What do we get for it?
Well, yeah. Larry says that they only pay when after they scrap the engines, right?
Right. That's correct.
Now, we'd like to know how many they've scrapped. So can you call your office and find out? We'll go on with something else.
Yes.
And then you can come back and let us know.
Yes, Dr. Book.
Thank you so much. Well, I'm amazed, Matt, that you don't know.
Dr. Burke, my staff tells me it's 38 have been paid for. They have 19 that are in the process of being shakedown and testing. So they actually took delivery of those 19. $38 million for 19 locomotives. I don't know how many are in service, though. Yeah, we'll find.
Okay. We have public comment on this. I'm not through yet. Oh, yes. We have a bunch of people. We have.
Trains are great. I want to talk about warehouses for a moment. We still have, I think, several big outstanding issues. But one is whether the credits accrue to the operator or to the owner of the facilities and how those transfer if they're relocations. A lot of companies, as they grow, move into bigger size warehouses. Are the credits going to stay with them or with the facility? So I know we're still.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, there's a lot of details that we need to sort out. And part of how we came to this place in looking at this menu approach is from better understanding the business models within the warehouse industry and how they work and the relationship between the operators with the owners and then the relationship with the trucks. So we're hoping that this concept can be flexible enough to accommodate those sorts of issues or situations. But you're right. There's a lot of detail that we still need to work out and be able to figure out how this will all hang together.
And then how are these rules and the SIP credit for them going to play out if some of these recommendations and best practices are adopted by local ordinance? Like, we in the county right now are considering moving from the menu option that we've had for the last more than a decade and putting them into requirement form. So how will that work?
Yeah, so if there's, we can't double count for emission reductions, right? So if there's already an existing ordinance in place that would get emission reductions that are associated with the WARE program, we would have to make sure that we back that out carefully when we're going to get, SIP credit for those emissions. So that's another thing that we have to take a look at.
Okay. Yeah, so something to consider in your point now, we're looking at doing it in the next couple months, so that
yes.
will change your... And finally, just for my colleagues, of course, the issue of the return to source, if these fees are being paid by warehouses, the money needs to go back to those communities that are bearing those warehouses.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Ms. Mitchell.
Thank you. Just a question on the warehouse rule. It's implicit in your presentation, Dr. Reese. The points I'm assuming will convert to fees or money at some point. Is that how it's going to be structured?
Yeah, the points that convert to emission reductions, or that we get attribute a certain number of points for actions that we then think are associated with giving emission reductions. It's a bit complicated because some of the actions we're looking at are things like infrastructure or solar panels, which don't necessarily translate directly into emission reductions. But our hope is that we can have some proxy for that, and so that would then eventually translate that way.
So not necessarily fees or collections of monies out of this program.
Well, that we are still developing, looking to see if there's some aspects of that that could be to translate. But again, we're very preliminary into this process.
The other thing that we've learned through our AB617 program is that many of the impacted communities are concerned about the truck routes for the warehouses. And that's, for us, jurisdictionally challenging. But I'm so pleased to hear that Supervisor Rutherford's county is thinking about looking at things like that. And I would encourage our agency to be working with the county planners, the local planners, as we go through this process. We may be able to get a little more authority, or at least coordinate on authority through that process. And thank you, Supervisor, for working on that with us.
Any other comments on this item? Thank you very much. We have public testimony.
Thank you much.
Number of people. We'll start out with Court Smith. And but after Ms. Smith is Linda Cleveland.
Hello. My name is Court Smith. I live in Riverside. And I am part of the Inland Empire Hub of the Sunrise Movement, a national youth-led organization dedicated to protecting our environment and our lives. Thank you for listening to residents' feedback about the development of an indirect sources rule. I'm excited about this rule's potential to push for greater investment in clean transportation like zero emissions and battery electric, to set reduction targets for emissions at ports, airports, warehouses, and rail yards, and to provide clean, local, zero-emission new jobs for our community. But I am also scared when I hear that our community could wait until 2020 for the proposed ISR to be considered, and potentially 2023 for implementation, because the health of our community members suffers with every minute more we must wait for action to clean up our air. So I would like to ask the board to please work as fast as possible to develop this rule for the sake of the health of our community. And I'm also scared that that this rule could not necessarily afford us the protections we need when I hear that things like near-zero vehicles may be considered as potential compliance options for this rule. And I would like to urge the board to stay focused on zero emissions compliance options only for this rule. And I would like to voice that I do not support government incentives for any combustion vehicles as part of this program. Thank you.
Yes, here she is.
Good morning. My name is Linda Cleveland, and I'm a stakeholder from Watts. I'm part of the Watts Clean Air and Energy Committee. And just sitting here this morning, my thoughts are all over the place because I'm listening to information that I've never heard before. And I'm wondering, where does my community fit into all these MOUs that you're talking about? Where does my community fit into all these credits that people are going to be able to purchase and continue to pollute my community? Where do we matter in all of this that's going on? I'm just amazed. We're surrounded by four freeways. We have airplanes flying over our community every day. We have trucks, construction trucks, semis, going through our community every day, polluting us. We have trucks parking by our schools and parks, idling and causing health issues for our children. Where do we matter in this whole ideology? Where do we matter? And I'm just overwhelmed at everything that's being said today. We need people that are going to advocate for us. We have trains coming through our community every day that are full of chemicals. And to learn that our fire departments are not even equipped to handle a spill, that people within a half an hour radius of where the spill takes place will have hundreds of people who die. Where do we matter? We need people to understand that Watts matter. We need people to advocate for us. Thank you.
I can, Mr. Chair, respond. Linda, we thank you for your presence and your advocacy. You've been a blessing to the Watts community. What you see, colleagues, before you is an advocate ensuring that we have clean air in the South Los Angeles Southeast area communities. Linda was instrumental, along with a number of community members, to advocate and push for the state to award a $35 million transformative community climate grant that came to Watts through the Watts Rising Initiative. We got a lot of work to do, clearly. And you heard earlier on the AQMP, specifically on the rails, on the rail lines that are coming through the Southeast cities and South Los Angeles. This AQMP will help hold those rail yards and BNSF UP accountable to ensure that we're using the best available technology when we're moving those goods through your communities. But thank you for joining us. Can't thank you enough. You've been, again, a blessing to the Watts community, to our city, and your voice is being heard, and you and many others in the South Los Angeles community. So appreciate you. Appreciate your presence.
Thank you.
Yassi Karazad. Did I mess it up too bad?
Yeah, you did. It's fine.
Hey.
Good morning. It's Yassi Kavizadeh. Next time we'll get it right.
I think I was close.
Yeah, pretty close. Good morning, everybody. It's good to see everyone here this morning, and I want to thank the previous speakers who came through. I'm a community organizer based in Riverside. I represent the Sierra Club and also representing myself as a resident of the Inland Region. And we're here today to actually thank the staff for trying their hardest on this rule. We are appreciative of the efforts that are going into this WARE program. We're happy it's not a trading type of thing going on, and we're still skeptical of some parts of it. So I just want to remind folks, this summer we had 83 consecutive ground-level ozone violations in the district. Last summer, we had 85 consecutive ground-level ozone violations. And you can fact-check me. I just fact-checked myself. But, you know, last year we had more wildfires, and there's a lot of, you know, I don't see the connection between wildfires anymore. This is an issue we're literally getting sick over. Children are getting sick over, and students are getting sick over contracting runner's asthma, contracting cancers. You know, this is ridiculous. And so we're here today to really, really nip the argument that a just transition to renewable natural gas or natural gas is feasible, because it's not. It's going to continue polluting us. And we understand that the Air District is really trying to, you know, we've seen the AQMD show up in many spaces promoting RNG technology, and that's not right. We should be seeing more spaces where we're working with industry and towards zero emissions. Why are we being one-sided with our approaches? And so that's where we're at, and how, and that's where I'm at actually as well. And our organization believes that we can have an equitable future towards energy storage and zero emissions infrastructure as soon as possible. So that's my comment today, and thank you so much for your time.
Thank you very much for your comments. No, no applause. Hold it. Hold it. Miguel Rivera.
Hello. Good morning. I'm Miguel Rivera. I'm also on the AB 617 committee for San Bernardino Muscoy. I'm here because I want to, you know, I'm not a morning person, so y'all really make me come here in the morning. So that's how important this is to me.
Next show's
And I just really want to push y'all to push for zero emissions and strong ISR. Our communities are sick, like everyone else has been saying before me. We need solutions, not a middle ground. We need to push forward zero emissions. Please take our communities and protect them. That's what y'all are supposed to do. So that's my comment for today. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your testimony. And we'll schedule the meeting later next. Angela Cardenas.
Second.
Yeah. We're going to have it at Supervisor Hahn's house, too.
Good morning.
Good morning. My name is Angela, and I'm coming from San Bernardino. Growing up, we lived inside a garage. My mom would never want me inside, so I was always outside in Moscow, running around, playing. I was a healthy little girl who did not have any breathing issues at first, but the more I would be outside of nowhere, I was having breathing problems, and my mom was wondering why. I was eating healthy and in the good physical shape, but then she took me to the doctors, and that's when I found out I had asthma. And the way I got my asthma was because we lived by a railroad, and it sucks. We are from a low-income family that can't afford to live somewhere without railroads or trucks coming in and out and warehouses around us. I was trying to live my childhood and just wanted to be outside, but since I learned about my asthma, my mom stopped me from being active outside. It made me miserable. There are hundreds of stories like mine here in this community. This is because of our air pollution. Moscow and San Bernardino has hundreds of corporations coming through, polluting and building warehouses next to homes and schools. They are using our communities for their profit. We have seen tons of activity and pollution from gas and diesel coming in and out of our communities. This summer alone, we had over 80 bad smoggy air days down the street. The San Bernardino Airport wants to expand, which means more pollution from trucks and planes. We don't know if these jobs are good for our communities. At the same time, these jobs are being automated and and they don't care about our lives. I don't want to accept this future for myself and for the rest of us, especially the youth. That's why I am here today, taking time to advocate for indirect source rule. We can do better and reduce air pollution for zero emissions. We must continue to build a better future for all and work together for it. That's why we are our fight for our earth across communities and organizations and beliefs. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Rudy Day Enda.
Good morning.
Hi.
I live in Bellflower, and I used to live in Belmont Heights, but with all the rent stuff that's going on, I was not evicted, but pushed out. And I ended up living in Bellflower between Lakewood and Bellflower, about four blocks south of the 91 freeway. And I noticed since I moved into that community, the freeway has changed my health. What I don't understand is why we're advocating for gas when we already have the technology for zero emissions. Why not be forethinking and aim for that and save money on switching from one technology to the next, to the next, to the next? Why not go directly to the best, to the future?
Hold on. Can you answer that question? Stop his time. Okay.
Our charge is to address public health. We can get 90% emission reductions today using existing technologies. The technology that's referred to as the future, we are all in. We are not one technology advocate. If we can get emission reductions today, if we can look at the investment horizon, so for instance, on the medium duty electric technology side, there's technology, and where that technology exists, we're all for it. But where the technology doesn't exist, where we're looking at anywhere from 3 to 5 to 7 years out, does it make sense to continue to allow 90% more emission reductions? And that's the challenge that we face, because if our charge is to protect public health and to improve public health, we can get those emission reductions today. But what we're being asked is look at the investment long term. And we agree from a long term perspective that's there. And that's why the district tries to incentivize the development. It's why we're working with Volvo. It's why we're working with Daimler, the big OEM, so that we can actually get that technology deployed. And I would just echo what many members of the board have said, what we've heard from ARB. When it comes to technology, we are all in. We're not advocating one over the other. What we are advocating is improved public health in the quickest way possible so that we can meet federal standards, and we can improve public health at the same time.
Thank you very much. Now you can continue.
And another point
I just want to hear the answer from them like you did.
Mm-hmm. And another point that I wanted to make, as I listened to your argument between you and the gentleman on that side regarding the rail, is you gave money away. And I don't see accountability. It's like me asking for a loan from my dad, and my dad asked me, what do you need it for? Well, I want to fix my house, which is house he lives in also. But then I either squander it or I fix it my way without consulting with him when he lives in the house and the money came from him. So to me, that's absurd.
To me too.
Yeah, it's.
That's why I was so upset.
It's like, wow.
Yeah, but I guarantee he didn't squander the money.
So anyway.
He just doesn't know where it's at.
Yeah.
Which makes me angry also.
I applaud Janice Hahn because I see she's on my side.
Yeah, I was gonna.
And I was born and raised in San Pedro, so, you know, she's doing a good job.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I was just going to respond to your plight of pushing the envelope to zero emissions. And I am absolutely on your side on that one. And I agree that we need to get the quickest emission reduction possible. But I'm on the side of creating policies that drive the marketplace. I think the more we demand zero emissions, the more, you know, the market will cooperate with us and develop these technologies quicker. For instance, on Metro, which provides all the transportation, rail, bus, for Los Angeles County, we just purchased 40 new all-electric buses. And if we ever expand the 710 freeway with an extra lane, I have pushed a policy that says it will be a zero emissions lane. So if you want to drive in that express lane, you have to be zero emission. Trucks coming from the port, vehicles, that's the only way you get in that lane. So I think we can work on today getting lower emissions, but I'm with you on sort of pushing the envelope and creating policies that demand that technology gets produced quicker and better. So thank you for your comments.
The world requires forward-thinking people. We're at a tipping point. I don't need to elaborate on that. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. Isra Richmond? I'm going to call the next person after him. And would they please come to the microphone to speak after him? That's Francis Young. Yang.
Good morning, those above me and those on the sides of me. Thank you for coming out today. I really applaud you guys for coming out and coming and speaking, and as well as being able to listen. So what I would like to talk about, is my time being started yet? Because it's not moving. Oh, do I have to press the green button?
Yeah.
Gotcha. So I know I could ramble on and on, but y'all want to be kind.
See, now I'm going to have to penalize you.
Anyway, so although we have our things that we're trying to do and we're trying to make sure we're doing everything, and trains are really amazing. I really hope that we can move on and improve for zero emissions for trains and everything else like that, and hopefully we do find out where that $50 million is, the case of the missing $50 million. So while we're out here pretending to be pseudo-morning people, so let's just go ahead and talk about the local planning and the execution that we need for it. Of course, we're going to need money for what we're doing. So I'm with you for seeing if we can do marketing or anything to see if we can actually try to make sure that we're going to push for it. But is there actually going to be anything done since we're actually right here, right in front of us? We're getting an example of things not really being done. So the problem would actually be is, what we're gonna go forth for zero emissions, or are we gonna go forth for a little bit of zero emissions? I'm pretty sure we can keep pushing the button to keep going forth for zero, and I'm really glad that you guys keep saying that you guys are for it and behind us as well. But what are you showing us? And I would like to be shown that this is what's happening, this is what we're doing. And so if we can work with them and have people, your people, talk with their people and see if they're able to, you know, immediately get that done, you know, expedite it, make it go express lane on that train or whatever else we need to do. We need to make sure we get zero emissions, not just particularly just a little tiny bit. So what are we going to do for that and for the years to come? And what are the actual numbers for that? And I know that we've had our phone call, and hopefully the phone call has been made so we can find out what that is approximately. Thank you for your time, guys. Hope you have a wonderful day.
Thank you. And would Abram Gastelum come to the microphone? Yes, you're up.
Great. Hi, my name is Francis. I'm a community organizer at the Sierra Club in South LA in Long Beach, and thank you for your time. So I just wanted to speak a little bit about how all this information is coming out, how there are tons of updates. Port are always coming out with different cap updates and everything, and it does look like RNG is at the forefront of our conversations, but I'd like to remind everybody of the events that happened the last couple weeks, specifically the youth climate strikes that's on everybody's minds. And our priorities are not just to clean up our air, which is obviously extremely important, and especially in prioritizing the impact zones, but also at the same time addressing our climate change and how the local responsibility is that everybody thinks globally about what we can do, or locally about what we can do, because we are all global players, especially in Southern California. So I ask that as you consider the new technologies, the MOUs that are now being decided for the next year, that we really prioritize during that time zero emissions and do everything we can, right, like Janice said, to push the envelope and make sure that we're not just going to settle for gas when this entire thing has been to say that we're trying to get off of this extractive economy and start to build a regenerative one where we can all live and communities can actually thrive within ourselves. And we can look to everybody like the AQMD say, thank you so much for cleaning us up. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your testimony. While Abram is speaking, would Peter Herzog come and be on standby?
Hello, my name is Abram Gastelum. I'm a local researcher in Riverside. My background's in study of labor and automation and infrastructure, but right now I'm just gonna talk about public health. So the goods movement industry is killing us. It's disgustingly dystopic to realize that we live in a world where it is understood that diesel and gas fuel is linked to numerous serious public health problems that result in premature death. We need zero emissions now and a strong indirect source rule to combat this diesel death. As ultra-fine particulate matter and organic vapors, diesel is piercing through our bodies, our cells, harming us irreversibly. Numerous studies by USC, UCLA, CARB, and the American Lung Association of California have shown increasingly alarming data that exposure to severe levels of diesel exhaust that currently exists throughout SoCal contributes to kids growing up with slow lung growth, decreased lung capacity, asthma development, and cancer risks. All this intensified by living in close proximity to rail yards, warehouses, and distribution centers that are rapidly becoming a festering presence throughout SoCal, most notably in Los Angeles and the Inland Empire. We need a firm indirect source rule now. It's unacceptable and irresponsible for the AQMD to aim for near zero emissions that bow meekly to industry stakeholders. The only justice is compliance options that position zero emissions equipment and infrastructure as the only option. Thank you.
Good morning, Mr. Chair, members of the board. My name is Peter Herzog. I'm with NAIOP, the Commercial Real Estate Development Association. It's a pleasure to be here with you today. And I want to comment on the update that you're receiving regarding the ISR for warehouses. This is something that, as you know, has been going on for some time. about 5 to 6 years more intensely. And over that time, it's been very clear, and actually staff has indicated very specifically that the focus on warehouses is to decrease truck emissions. The second focus is, and it was indicated what has to come out of this, and it was reiterated again today, that you have to get SIP credit as well. And over that 5 to 6 years, we have to date still not received any information as to what kind of emissions could be achieved by any ISR, as well as if you could get SIP credit for any. And now we've kind of moved on where there's this new concept that came out in August, the WARE program that Dr. Reese spoke of. And in the discussion so far on this specific rule that is indicated they want to go to the board on in May, there still is no assessment of the emissions, if any, that might be achieved. There's still no indication that it could get SIP credit, and there's no information on what the cost of this rule might be. Additionally, you know, there's talks of the point system. It's very clear there's really no information now how you would take the number of trucks that come to a warehouse, which is what it's based on, how that would translate into points. How does that happen? There's also no information, and you didn't have the list in front of you, but of the so-called action items. How do those items translate it into points that you could achieve? So in other words, how do you get, what points are going to be hit with, and then how many, you know, how can you get them back? We still have no information on that at all. So basically, kind of the update is, there are numerous questions. And very few answers. And, you know, it was indicated by staff, and this is certainly, we certainly agree with, this is very early on. It's very conceptual. And yet, what also staff has indicated, and this wasn't in your report today, they're indicating they're going to release an actual rule for review in mid-November. That's only a month and a half tops. And so, you know, we certainly have been involved in this for, as I said, over 5 years so far. We will certainly continue to work with the board, with staff on this issue. And I just like kind of want to leave you with a couple last thoughts. The AQMD has always indicated they want to work, and actually I'll close with this, quite frankly, that you always want to work with the best science and the best analysis. And so we certainly look forward to working with staff on a realistic analysis of those facts, of the technology that's out there, of a true actual analysis of what's going on, and we look forward to working with you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thomas Jelinek comes to the microphone to be followed by Chris Shimada.
Good morning, Chair, board members. My name is Thomas Jelinek with PMSA. We represent the marine terminals and ocean carriers that serve California's ports. I want to continue some of the comments that you heard from Peter.
Just a moment.
Yes.
You can start his time anytime. Thank you.
So where was I? So. To continue the comments that Peter had, as your staff has indicated to us that they're going to be releasing a proposal in just a month's time. Yet, as you heard from the staff presentation today, a lot of the hard questions about how this rule, how these set of rules are going to work have not been answered. One of the things we're particularly concerned with is that staff is on one track for warehouses and a different track for ports. Ultimately, this is one logistics network, and the transportation network that serves warehouses also needs to serve ports, and we don't see how these rules will end up being compatible. One of the things we're deeply concerned about is a quilt work of different requirements at facilities across Southern California that would make compliance simply impossible. And we are also concerned about, you know, one of the most important things about this entire effort, why we're engaged in this, is the SIP credit. There's been no discussion about what is the SIP creditable emissions associated with these rules. And as some commenters during the Mobile Source Committee last week pointed out, there may not, in fact, be SIP creditable emission reductions from some of these efforts. And with 30 days or so going until we see draft regulation, it's really surprising that we have not seen the analysis necessary to say, how will these different disparate rules work together, and what will be the benefit that we're going to achieve from them? I look forward to continuing to work with the board and the staff on these rules, and thank you.
I think your comments have great merit. Great merit.
Good morning, Chairman Burke and members of the board. Chris Shimoda, California Trucking Association. Did want to highlight some of the concerns already noted by staff on the warehouse ISR item on the subject of SIP credit that Thomas just spoke to. The menu of compliance options presented so far consist of many mobile sources such as zero emission and low NOx trucks, TRUs and infrastructure already subject to CARB regulation whose anticipated emission reductions have already been incorporated into the 2016 SIP. So it's difficult to see how this proposed rule is going to generate SIP credit when we're going to have to go in excess of what are some very aggressive targets that CARB has already set out for these sources. So just on that item. On the issue of incentives, this is a big concern of ours. We're being told that ISRs may prevent incentives from going towards zero emission projects in the South Coast Basin if they're subject to this regulation. And in our opinion, this is going to delay the very progress that I think we all seek for the technology. It's going to result in billions of dollars of public and private investment going to other regions to push zero emissions. Unfortunately, because of the high upfront cost of the technology, incentives are necessary to make zero emission projects pencil out. There was a Luskin study that got a lot of attention this week talking about total cost of ownership for zero emission port trucks penciling out. That study relied on $250,000 worth of grants in order to make that those numbers work. So it's something to consider. Any regulation that would prevent incentives from going towards zero emissions is going to be harmful to our shared cause. And since Supervisor Cacciotti did bring it up, SB 210, heavy-duty inspection and maintenance, I am happy to report that the CTA did work with Senator Leyva and ARB to get to an agreement on that proposal moving forward. There's about 10% of the trucks on the road that do not meet, that are not maintaining their emission controls in the manner that they need to and are creating about half of the emissions overall. And so if we can identify those folks, get them fixed, we can get about a 40 to 50% reduction just from that alone. And so we're not sitting idly by. We are working on a lot of other things to try to get to cleaner air. And so specific to ISRs, there are many questions, as you've heard from other commenters. We look forward to participating in the process moving forward, and thank you for the time.
Yes.
Just a question. How did you arrive at the 10% of the vehicles aren't in compliance? You said there's that top 10% is creating half the pollution. How did you arrive at that among your members?
So there are two, because it was discussed earlier, there are two separate metrics. There's around 20 to 30% of the trucks that don't comply with the CARB truck and bus rule. But of the trucks that are 2010 or newer, CARB has done studies about the maintenance of the emission control systems. They did some studies over at the Port of Oakland where they found it's about 10% of the trucks that are gross emitters producing about 50% of the emissions. And I'd be happy to provide that study to the board.
Thanks. Thanks.
Thank you.
Dominic Falzone.
Good morning. Thank you for considering my input. I live in Los Angeles. I'm a member of the Sierra Club. And I think that we need to get rid of pollution now. No more stalling, no more half measures. We've already had to breathe bad air for decades. We've had 85 consecutive days of bad air last year, and that's unhealthy for everyone under 18 years old. And for everyone who's over 65 years old, including myself. One of the previous speakers, I believe he represents the management of the maritime industry, complained, was worried that you might have a quilt work of varying regulations And the way to solve that is to implement the strictest possible regulation over all segments of industry. I believe that improving the air quality, fighting pollution will be beneficial for people in all types of jobs and professions, and ranging from minimum wage security guards to people who are very rich. I just retired as a 30-year career working as a union member, and before that, I was in two previous unions, and I believe that fighting pollution will help help labor members, labor union members, and working people. Sometimes selected members of labor unions have complained that implementing tougher environmental regulations will cost jobs and hurt working people, and I disagree with that. I believe that the AQMD needs to develop a strong rule to control pollution from the warehouse industry, eliminate trucks which are powered by diesel fuel, by gas, or by natural gas. And I'd also like to see you get electric ground handling support equipment and cargo handling equipment at the airport, which is zero emission. San Francisco Airport has already adopted a regulation that will make the airport already electric by 2023. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your testimony.
Can I comment, Mr. Chair?
Surely.
You know, I do think there is a bit of a tough line that we're going to walk when it comes to clean air and emission reductions at the port, because we've seen industry attempt to automate a lot of the cargo movement, claiming that that's the only way they can have zero emissions. And, you know, I think we always need to take a stand and say, you don't have to automate to make it clean air. A lot of, for instance, those top handlers we unveiled yesterday, those are still take jobs to run them. So you can have clean air and good jobs, and I think we always just have to keep saying that. I know that's going to be my message. We just need to be careful when we're demanding clean air that the industry doesn't come in and say, well, the only way we can achieve it is by automation.
You can have both.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Could we have staff respond to the industry's concern about SIP credit and the 30 days? We're going to have a draft rule on the floor.
I'm sorry, Larry.
Could we have staff respond to the industry's concern about the SIP credit issue and the fact that we're going to have a draft rule on the comment in 30 days?
Yes. Good morning, members of the board. This is Philip Fine, Deputy Executive Officer, Planning and Rules Division. Yeah. SIP credit has always been a complicated thing, even in the traditional sense, when we're passing, you know, our normal rules on stationary sources. So this is no different, and it is a little bit new. But the trick of SIP credit is there could be several regulations that push and pull industry to do essentially the same thing. You heard about complaints about a patchwork of regulations, but this has often been the case. CARB can have a standard for selling new vehicles, making sure that some percentage is clean. There could be in-use requirements. There could be engine standards. And then what we're working on is providing the pull at the ports, at the warehouses, at the rail yards, to pull that clean equipment to those locations. So these regulations do have to work together, and they will create change. They will create more cleaner vehicles, but you can only take SIP credit once. So it's complicated, but it can be worked out. It can be worked out prospectively when we pass the regulations. That's more difficult. But once we know those clean trucks are on the road, They register those trucks, we have that data, and then we can get SIP credit after that happens. And that's also important. So there's several ways to get SIP credit. We don't know the emission reductions for these measures we're proposing yet because we have not got to the point of stringency yet. So the commenters spoke to having a lack of details and a lot of questions. Dr. Reese said the same thing. There's a lot of details to be worked out, and we don't know about how many emission reductions we can get until we do that analysis. We want to come out with a draft rule in November to get the discussion started. By no means is that going to be final. We often will release early drafts of rules to get the discussion going, and there could be two or three or four additional revisions before it comes to the board. We're trying to move quickly. The board put us on this direction over 2 years ago, or a year and a half ago, I'm sorry, and we want to get to May. If we need to take longer, we could take longer. But the first step is getting those concepts on paper, getting people to talk and give us their feedback and revise as we go forward. So most people, when we're working on a rule, are always asking, can we see the rule language? Can we see the rule language? We can't comment till we see the rule language. So we want to get something out there to get that discussion started.
But in keeping with that, I must say, in all the time I've been here, I've never seen us start the rule and go to the public with as few answers to questions that are major questions in the rule as we are in this particular case.
Yeah, so again, this is new. ISR rules are complicated. We have not attempted this before in this area. This concept of the point system we developed in August, and there's obviously a lot of details, but putting it into a rule framework does help the discussion going forward. But by no means what we would release in November is final. There's a lot of unanswered questions, but this is new territory, and we're exploring it with everyone. If through the working groups we're not ready for a rule in November to put language out, then we wouldn't put language out. But we're trying to move the process forward.
Dr. Berg?
That might be a little difficult for the public to understand.
Dr. Burke, if I could add, we have been working on this process for 2 years, and we actually embarked on a different approach at the very beginning. And I think it was through that process where staff felt that there were significant opportunities, but it really was unworkable. And we listened to the comment that we received, and we paused, and we took redirection. And now we've come out in a different direction. So the fact that we're listening to everybody, that we're trying to develop a program that is effective, I think is borne out by this process. And all the questions that have been answered, we intend to answer. We know that you as a governing body need to know these kind of answers in order to justify moving forward on it. So we're gonna have these answers. We're making sausage, may not necessarily be pretty, but we're gonna get there. And I assure you it will be an outcome that we can all hopefully approve and recognize that it's going to provide those clean air benefits and all the other things that I know are so important to all of us.
Okay, we'll see. Will Chris Chavez please come to the vacant microphone?
So, good morning, members of the board and Chair Burke. It's a pleasure to see you all in person today. And I also want to thank you for holding a board meeting outside of your usual headquarters of Diamond Bar. I think it's incredibly important to be more accessible and transparent to the community. And I think, as we just saw, sometimes a board presentation and even a working group may not be the best venue to have these complicated conversations with community members. And so I really want to both thank the staff for their diligent work in making these meetings more accessible to the community, but also committing, or at least letting us know that you have intention to hold a community meeting in the communities that are affected by these rules, specifically holding a community meeting in the inland region where that community is impacted the most by warehousing development, and also in South LA, which are of course affected by the port complexes. we heard this update also on the September 20th Mobile Source Committee. And I want to say I'm just amazed at how many great announcements we've heard since not even a month ago. We've heard the announcement of, first we saw the largest climate strikes. We saw some of the largest original equipment manufacturers announce that they are going all in on zero emission for Class 8 heavy-duty trucks. We saw Amazon announce a purchasing of 100,000 electric delivery trucks, and of course the Port of LA also unveiling the world's first zero emission top pick handler, which of course was also incentivized not only by the Ports Fund but AKMD funding. And I say that all because it's becoming clear that while things are changing faster than ever, we will never see a pace of change this slow again. And communities are already dying from having to wait year after year for their air to be cleaner. Community had to swallow a bitter pill had to inhale polluted air when we heard that the warehouse rule would not be considered this year. As Dr. Fine said, that the board originally indicated that this rule would go before the board in November of 2019. Well, that is next month, and we're very, very far away from a rule. And so while I know that the rule took a new direction and it was actually the community input that may have resulted in this new timeline, I want to really press the board that please do all you need to do to keep this timeline and not push back the date any further. In consideration of how the other rules will work for the ISR, not just the warehouse, the community and industry players really need to understand how these rules work together. And I really believe that the warehouse rule is one of the first most important critical rules for all the pieces. We know that this is a complex rule and that in every sector you'll have your challenges. It's often the case that every sector you're not able to tackle the largest polluters. With rail yards, you can't tackle the locomotives because they're federally pre-exempt. With ports, you can't tackle the ocean-going vessels because they are exempt. With airports, you can't tackle the airplanes because they are federally exempt. That is not the case with many of the trucks and the off-road emissions that we are seeing, and we are also seeing tackled through proposal. So I urge the board to continue.
Thank you for your testimony.
Sure.
Even though I got confused at the part where we slowed you down, but you should hurry up.
Well, we originally were told that the ISR warehouse rule will be up for consideration in November of 2019, and now the new schedule is May of 2020. So we're really urging you today to not push back the date any further from May of 2020. We have heard from several community members and speakers.
Thank you. Carla DeCruz?
You already called him.
Yes. Oh, I'm sorry. Your name for the record is?
Yes, my name is Chris Chavez. I am the Deputy Policy Director for the Coalition for Clean Air. First, I'd like to thank those who participated in our second annual Clean Air Day, which was on October 2nd. Regarding the warehouse ISR, I want to speak that we're supportive of some of the concepts, particularly transitioning from a credit-based system to a point-based system for the warehouse ISR. Again, I know a lot of folks mentioned that there are multiple questions that have been raised due to this change. However, we look forward to continuing to participate in this process. We still have concerns about the port MOU, namely that the MOU is not publicly available yet, and we encourage the board to release that MOU to the public for review as soon as possible. Additionally, we want to also make sure that the reductions from the ports are real and quantifiable, and that the MOU should close off any loopholes for missed commitments and off-ramps. And then lastly, on the MOU itself, or on the port MOU itself, I should say, we do also have an ongoing concern that the MOU is a voluntary agreement rather than a requirement. So we want to make sure that whatever product that the AQMD develops is as strong as possible. Regarding the rail yards, certainly the rail yards should be commended for their emission reductions that are reported today, but it still goes without saying that the communities that are around rail yards are still disproportionately impacted by air pollution. As a resident of West Long Beach near a rail yard, I certainly understand that issue. It just goes to show that there's a lot that needs more that needs to be done to make sure that the communities surrounding rail yards have parity with the rest of California and aren't suffering the health impacts from the emissions from their operations. And then last point, We just want to say that we're pleased with the direction of the airport MOU and certainly want to make sure that this agency continues going down the path of pursuing the strongest emission reductions from the airports as well. So certainly this is a, you know, some good things out of this update, some things that we want to see stronger out of this update. And again, we commit ourselves to continue to work with AQMD, the board members themselves and the staff in making the most effective plan possible. Thank you very much for your time.
Carla De La Cruz. It seems like we have a number of duplicates here. I was just going through here. Because Abraham Gosselum spoke, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And Miguel Rivera spoke, right? Double cards. How about one name only? This is like Sinatra, only it's Cardenas. Cardenas? Judy Patterson. Yay. Ms. Patterson.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak today. My name is Judy Patterson, and I drove a Volkswagen Jetta diesel for several years. This was the car with the emissions cheat software that was eventually uncovered. The car was forced off the road. I drove about 50 miles per day in what I was told by VW was one of the greenest cars on the road. I think CARB was part of the investigation. I discovered I was polluting the air up to 30 times the legal limit. I'm now doing what I can to support organizations like the Sierra Club to reduce emissions and to undo some of the damage that I personally did. Whether they are doing it legally or illegally, we need to crack down on transportation companies who think they can use our air as a sewer. Thank you for being here today, and thank you to the Sierra Club.
And thank you for your testimony. Jan Victor and F. Anderson. Hello? I saw you get up. But you got to come. Okay.
Hello. Ooh, this is going to fall. Cool. And then I'm supposed to push a button or something?
No.
Oh, cool. Good afternoon, board members. My name is Jan Victor Andasen. I have lived in Carson for the 20-some years of my life living in this country and organizing with residents in West Long Beach for almost 6 years. I am a member and organizer with East Yard Communities for Environmental Justice. And like many of the residents that were able to come here today and leaders in groups, we're here because we want the Air District to be an agency that regulates existing and new policies. So the things that you've already made and the new policies you're introducing to safeguard our health, as Wayne Nastry had said earlier. And we need you to enforce. That's also one of your jobs. We need you to do your job. And so I'm here today as a resident, as somebody that grew up actually in West Long Beach, right next to the rail yard, which has a very different impact from a rail line, because a rail yard doesn't just attract the cars driving there to commute from point A to B. Rail yards have trucks that are coming daily. I will speak about the West Long Beach, the rail yard right next to West Long Beach, Union Pacific. At this, currently, generally, their numbers stand at about 725,000 truck trips annually. And so that's a lot of trucks that are probably using diesel. That is a different impact from metro lines. And so when you live right next to a rail yard, you're not just breathing in the dirty air, you're also dealing with constant noise. And I want to lift that specific issue up because as y'all are creating this indirect source rule, we want you to go after what's bringing more pollution into already overpolluted neighborhoods. When I came here to the U.S., I didn't have asthma, and in less than a year, I was diagnosed with asthma. So that was from 97 to 98. And coming back to work in East Yard in West Long Beach, when I came back after 3 years of working with East Yard in West Long Beach, I had to buy an inhaler. And do you know how much it costs to buy an inhaler? Even with medical insurance, it costs $80. And so that's just for one person with insurance. What about the many others that can't afford it? And so that's why we need y'all to regulate. We need y'all to think about how this connection, this logistics movement that one of the gentlemen said, I think it was Chris Shimoda or something, that they're all connected to each other. Well, they're also connected to polluting our neighborhoods, our health. They're coming from the ports, going through the freeway, and running into the warehouses, and that's all around our neighborhoods. And we're breathing that all in. So then this policy should not just really look at how they're all connected. You should enforce them in all the ways that you're able to, because some of us don't have the $80 to spend to get another inhaler. And some of us also don't have that second. If you don't have that inhaler, when you get an asthma attack, you might not make it. And in this current, in 2019, it is obscene for somebody to die from an asthma attack. And so we want you to enforce existing policies, build new policies, and do your job and protect our health. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Luis Portillo. I'm with the Inland Empire Economic Partnership, and I wanted to just come here to express some concern about the indirect source rule and its possible impact that it could have on the economy of the Inland Empire. You know, our region has really made it a priority to attract the logistics industry, something we had decided that's a priority for us, and it worked. You know, absent the jobs that were created in the logistics industry, our region would still be in recession. So when we look at that, one of the concerns is that this rule will simply become a way to generate new revenues, a new tax on these industries without really resulting in any significant reductions or improvements in the air quality. As you look at this rule, we hope, urge you to really consider, you know, what effects could it have? Is it gonna force some of these companies just move their distribution centers to Arizona, to Las Vegas? In which case, we will still keep getting the pollution, we'll still keep getting the trucks coming through our neighborhoods, but we won't be getting any of the benefits. You know, we want clean air. I grew up in Muskoy, which is one of the communities that was designated this year. My family still lives there. And so when I hear about options, ways to improve the air in a way that's quick, that's effective, and people are opposed to it, that really confuses me. So the perfect example is what Mr. Nastri said earlier about trucks. Natural gas, 90% cleaner. These are trucks that are available now. These are changes you could make right now. Yet, when we talk about electric's great, but the scale at which you would need to permeate these trucks into the fleet isn't gonna happen in the next year. It's not gonna happen in the next 5 or 10 years, it's 20 years. And so what you're essentially telling people, if you oppose natural gas, even as a way, as a middle ground, you know, for the next, you know, right now, you're essentially saying, hey, for you, for your kids, we're gonna need you to keep breathing the same type of air right now for the next 10 years, for the next 20. Maybe by the time your grandkids will be born, these trucks will be in there, be able to make a difference. So I just wanna make sure, to urge you to, one, keep that as an option. Don't take it off the table, because, you know, when you look at these communities, we want clean air. We don't care how you do it. If you do it electric, great. If we don't do it natural gas, doesn't matter. Is my air getting cleaner? That's what I'm after. And so I urge the AQND to continue pursuing their approach, which is, hey, let's use all the options available, and that if we have ways to achieve some of these reductions in the short run, in a way that's done quickly and cost-effectively, we urge you to do so. Thank you.
God, I have the honor of being the last speaker. Wow. Okay. Good morning. So my name is Taylor Thomas. I'm with East Yard Communities for Environmental Justice, born and raised in Long Beach. Oh my God, don't put that camera on my hair. Oh my God. Oh my God. Let me just turn this way. it is kind of done, believe it or not, but anyways, I'm wasting my time. So again, good morning. I'm coming to you from Long Beach. When I was thinking about coming to this meeting last night, I honestly felt like, you know, I shouldn't be here, right? Why am I gonna spend an hour in traffic, find out I gotta pay $20 to come to this nice hotel to be here? But in the spirit of my work, I always come to these types of meetings to represent the community members that can't attend, right? So I get here, you know, I see we're in a nice hotel, come upstairs, and you all are putting on clean air awards, right? And to me, that's a little surprising. especially given, you know, the history with the Environmental Justice Awards. I see that there's a lot of effort into putting into celebrating the progress of clean air, right? So I'm just asking that you all take that same effort into improving public health, right? So I'm here specifically to speak to the issues of the ports. MOUs don't work. Mitigation fees don't work. We know this. You know this. I think everybody in this room knows this. So it is a little outrageous to see that that's still a consideration, given how celebratory folks are feeling. And I hope the folks at the Port of Long Beach still talk to me after this, because I actually like them. They're really cool. But yeah, again, I think, you know, it's outrageous to see that these voluntary measures are still being considered, you know, given that the emission inventories from the ports shows that there's been increases in certain categories, right? And there are projected to continue to increase for the next two decades. And so I'm here to tell you all that I want you to direct the staff to look at a port backstop rule. I know that's a dirty word. I'm sorry, Heather. I'm sorry, Matt. But that's kind of what we need, right? We can't continue business as usual. We can't talk about all the progress we've made when there hasn't been that much progress, right? When you dig down into the data, 5% reductions over the course of 14 years, that's failing, in my opinion. Maybe folks have other standards. But yes, so I want you all to direct the staff to look into a port backstop rule for the ports. And let's remember that while we're celebrating, some of us are not. We're living with these impacts every day. We're living with these impacts for years, and we can't talk about how great we are when we actually look at the data and we're showing we're doing the bare minimum. So thank you.
Judy Patterson already testified, right? Yes. Then that concludes our cards that the people who would like to testify on this issue. Now, this is a...
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I wanted to save my comments until after public comments, so if you wouldn't mind. In looking at all of these measures that we're considering, the one thing that stands out to me is that the MOUs are the things that are moving forward the most quickly, and the ISRs are the ones that are the most complex. And I know that it's not necessarily an apples-to-apples comparison with each one of these issues, but it seems to me that when we're working on a memorandum of understanding, that we have a little more collaboration than when we use the word rule. And regardless of how we term it, we need to have more of that collaboration between industry, all the stakeholders, the environmental community, and staff. And I know that you all are trying to do that as much as you possibly can in Diamond Bar, but I just want to encourage more of that because, you know, again, when we're talking about some of the rules, the words that kept jumping out were complexity and preliminary, and this is going to be really challenging and it's hard. And the only way that we can make that work is that if we're collaborating with one another. So again, just want to try to encourage that as much as possible. And then I also wanted to talk a little bit about some of the reasons why we're seeing some of the problems that we do. So we're talking a little bit about the rail and Amtrak and Metrolink and, you know, all those sorts of issues. What we're trying to do is push industry to commercialized technology that 10 years ago, there were many people who probably sat on this board that thought it wouldn't happen in 100 years, let alone 10. And every meeting we're talking about something new that's being tested. Just today, Supervisor Hahn mentioned the two top picks down at the port, and there's two, and they need to be tested, and that's what's going on. But they're not ready for wide-scale commercial use. It's not a matter of money. It's a matter of, does the technology actually work? And we need to make sure that happens, because if we don't, we're going to pour a lot of money into something that doesn't work, and every single one of us in this room should be frustrated by that. And we are. When we spend a lot of money on buses that end up having a lot of challenges, or we spend money on engines for locomotives and maybe they don't function the way they need to. So we need to be cautious, and we want to move as quickly as we can. Believe me, every single one of us sitting up here want to move as quickly as we can, but we don't want to pour tons and tons, millions and millions of dollars towards something that in the end doesn't work the way we want it to. We have to be systematic about this approach. And Mr. Chairman, I just want to say how much I appreciate the opportunity that you've given me over the last 4 years of serving on the Technology Committee. I've had the opportunity to watch a lot of these projects birth. Again, from situations where you just felt like this would never happen, and then we're working on it. But it is a process, okay? So those that want us to go to zero emission immediately, we want to be there too. But the technology is not there. I was at the unveiling of the Tesla truck. It's been, I think, close to 2 years now. Doesn't exist on the road. There's a handful of them, but no one can buy them, right? And then we have the hydrogen trucks out there with Nikola. As I mentioned a few months ago, 7-year waiting list to get a truck, okay? This is a company that can start manufacturing them soon, but a 7-year waiting list if you want to get one right now. So those are the realities that we have to deal with. And should we push? We absolutely need to. And I think that we're doing that every single day at the district, and we're doing it as a board every time we're in a committee meeting or up here as a full board. But we have to be cognizant of those realities, and we need to work together, we need to collaborate. So thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much for your comments. Any other comments by any of my colleagues?
Yes.
Okay, Ms. Mitchell.
I just want to follow up on what my colleague has just stated. We're an agency that is charged with protecting the public health. And all of us want to get to zero emission, but as we recognize in the heavy duty sector, we are not there. We're looking at anywhere from 5 to 7 years before zero emission heavy duty trucks are commercially available. And what we know from the science that we have learned in our examination of pollution is that NOx combines with sunshine to create ozone, and ozone is a pollutant that is very damaging. And we've just learned that ground level ozone is particularly damaging and that we're breathing a lot more of it than we thought we were. So when I think about the public health aspects that we're dealing with, and that we may have 7 years more before we get to zero emission heavy duty vehicles, my concern is that that child that is born today will breathe for 7 more years something that we could improve upon with the near zero emission heavy duty technology that is commercially available today. So it has always been my position not to forego near zero, but to use it as we can use it in the next number of years to reduce ozone pollution and to improve the public health of our population, and to particularly pay attention to children who are exceptionally vulnerable to this kind of pollution. We're charged with that. We are charged with looking at public health. And so I think we need to be practical as well as idealistic when we think this is what we can do now with near zero technology, and never lose sight of what we can do in the future with zero emission technology as it becomes more available and commercially out there on the street where you can buy it at a reasonable price and use it to best advantage. Thank you.
Supervisor.
Thank you. And I certainly appreciate that. I know Mayor Mitchell and I have had this conversation a lot. And I'm starting to, the only argument I'm starting to buy a little bit is the fact that unless we have this interim of near zero before we get to zero, then in fact the industry will move quickly to automate to get to the clean air goal. But I will say the Clean Air Action Plan at our ports have created, because it was a policy that was implemented, it created a laboratory at our ports where we've seen enormous amount of clean air technology entrepreneurship come as a result of the policymakers saying, this is the goal, this is what we will do. And I honestly believe a lot of those businesses would not have existed if we had not had this very strict laboratory out at our ports. So one of the things I would like to see us make sure we're paying attention to, though, are these pilot projects, which I agree. We're trying to collect the data to see whether or not these all-electric top handlers actually work. But as Mayor Garcetti from Los Angeles said, he's the first to say, try it at our port. We are offering up our port. Try it here. And I think that's what we need to also push for. There, we do have, I believe, I forget how many of the all-electric trucks that we have in a pilot program at our ports. I want to say, is it less than 20? It's less than 20. Is it five? It's 10. But again, at least there's 10 of those being piloted. So I would like to see us, as the agency responsible for public health, that we push the ports, the airports, to be the one to step up and say, we'll try it here. And then, we're going to fight with those who would say we're making our ports less competitive. At some point, listening to all the testimony, why should the health and safety of the people who live along the diesel death zone be compromised so that, you know, somebody in Kansas can get their flat screen TV, you know, next day delivery on their shelf in Walmart? So goods movement is clearly the economic engine. You know, over 40% of the trade comes through this country comes through our ports, but we're paying a price for that. And so at what point do we say, you know what, that electric top handler is good enough? Maybe it's a little bit slower. Maybe it does have to stop to charge up. But at one point, do we also say, you know what, that's worth the payoff of better health and cleaner air for our residents? And I see that as maybe the fight we're still going to have to fight down the road, trying to remain competitive, but saying it's worth something to have zero emissions. Maybe it's slower, maybe it's not quite as effective, but it's a payoff that I think we all need to be united in saying it's worth it. Does that make sense?
Yes. Anyone else? I'd just like to say a couple of things. One, I'd like to apologize to Ms. Cleveland if had known her, and or if Councilman Buska, you know, had recommended her. We had a meeting of civic leaders on the 617 rule this past week, and it was on the front page of the Sentinel yesterday that we were meeting with civic leaders in the community to not only improve conditions but to make people aware of what's available, the resources that are available, because there are resources available, and more as every day goes by. At my house, I'm kind of a joke. When I start talking about when I came to Los Angeles, my kids look at me, and the standard line is, Dad, when you came to Los Angeles, there were still dinosaurs on Wilshire Boulevard. Well, that's not true. But when I did come here, there were many days that you couldn't drive on the freeway. Forget going out to play baseball. In those days, there were 80 and 90 car collisions on any given freeway because the cars could not see one another. So when you talk about lack of progress, this is in my lifetime. This is since I've been an adult. When I came to this agency, they were dealing with PM10, which is a very fine particle which can transmit through the air and into your body. Now we're talking, we talked about PM10, then we talked about PM5, now we're talking about PM2.5, and now we're talking about nanoparticles. Now, PM10 to a nanoparticle must look like a grain of sand to a boulder. And that's the progress we've made since I've sat on this board. So it may not, I know it's not enough. And I know it's not fast enough. But the progress is amazing. Yeah. So all these people up here spend all this time trying to do the job that is really, I had a meeting yesterday with Dr. Black. Dr. Black is the guy who said, and this really shook me to my root. He said, in your life, you can control the amount of exercise you do. You can control the amount of food you eat. But you cannot control the air you breathe. So everybody up here knows it's a grave responsibility that we have to everyone in San Bernardino, Riverside, Orange County, and LA County. So when you say we're not moving fast enough, it's not because we're not trying. So that's my comment for the day. On item 31, do we need a presentation?
Sir, there's no public comments. It's something that we've been working on.
I have no public comment.
Staff's willing to waive presentation.
Stay again. I do have some. Oh, this is, no, this is public comment. I have no comment.
Staff's willing to waive presentation.
Okay. I'll second Joe's motion.
Okay. Any opposition? Hearing none.
Mr. Chair.
That item is approved. We'll move to a public comment.
Dr. Burke, could you call the roll, please?
I'm sorry?
Call the roll.
I'm sorry, no, we're good. Okay. My apologies.
Thank you.
He said we're okay.
No, he's good. On public comment, we'd like Gene Lee to come to the microphone.
He just left.
And how about, it looks
George
like...
George Draculius, yeah.
How do you think?
Hey. Hi. Yeah, it's George Draculius, spelled like it sounds, from Los Angeles. I'm here on a semi-selfish, but I think also a problem that affects a lot of Southern California, which is wood-burning restaurants. My wife, Lita, has written to all your board members about a restaurant called Auburn, and you haven't seen?
Yeah, we're having trouble hearing you. Could everyone in the audience please close it and we can shut the door? Thank you.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Start again, please. You want to start again?
Sure.
George Draculius, Los Angeles. I am in show business. But with a problem, selfish problem, but I think one that affects Southern California, which is wood-burning restaurants. My wife, Lita, has written to the board, I don't know if you've gotten her email, about the effect of a restaurant called Auburn that has recently opened in our neighborhood and how it's affected our neighbors. She sent an attached video with the smoke pouring out, and so you could see. Since the restaurant is open, we have been working with the AQMD inspectors to get a restaurant to put a proper filter, and we've done everything we've asked, but it seems like rules are constantly changing in the 7 months, and we are still breathing this smoke. One of the families has a newborn baby who has been breathing wood smoke for the past 5 months of her life. My wife has developed chronic bronchitis and is living with her relatives in Washington, D.C. right now. In New York, Boston, Philadelphia, and other cities, the nuance violation has been successful in prompting use to protect their citizens from cancer-causing smoke. Why not Los Angeles? 10 years ago, the AQMD outlawed construction of fireplaces because of danger of wood smoke's PM2.5 seeping into the neighbors' houses. Why can wood-burning smoke, restaurant wood-burning smoke, pour into our houses in LA without proper filtration? Just quickly, I love to eat. I eat at wood-burning restaurants. My favorite restaurant in the world is literally a half a block away from this other restaurant, and there's no problem there. I think they've done their diligence to get proper filtration. You can eat in the restaurant, you can stand there, and you never even notice. Is there anything else we can do as a community to help?
My staff assistant gave me a copy of the communication that you sent, and I immediately forwarded it to our executive director and asked him to make sure that everything that we could do, we would do to make sure that the proper retrofitting of any filters or arresters could be done. And why don't I just ask him while you're here,
okay,
what's going on?
Okay.
So, Dr. Burke, I'm going to have Marion Coleman, our deputy for enforcement and compliance, go through a detailed history of our responses, the actions that have taken place, and what we're continuing to do with regards to the Auburn restaurant. Marion.
Good morning, Dr. Burke and board members. We are our office does, we do share the concerns that the community has regarding the smoke and odor emissions at this facility. We have investigated complaints. We've issued a notice of violation for creating a public nuisance. We continue to survey the area to monitor for visible emissions. In fact, after our notice of violation was issued, the facility installed a carbon filter on their stack as a means to attempt to reduce the emissions and the odors. We've recently received other complaints. That was in March of 2019. And so, the installation of the carbon filter was later done in September of this year. And so we are working with the facility. I'm sorry.
Do you know when this was
done? Yes, I have the exact date here. First week in September.
It's different, but it's still very rancid and smelly.
Okay.
They play like whack-a-mole.
I got it.
Oh, okay.
So what we've done, Dr. Burke, is we continue to go out and perform surveillances, and we also do visible emission readings. Our inspectors are certified to read smoke through the California Air Resources Board, and so we have observed some emissions. They're less than the amount that we would issue a citation for, but we are continuing talks with the company to see what further means they can do to reduce the emissions.
Well, look, if this organization restricts char broiling, I don't understand how you can have a wood-burning place where the neighbors are experiencing.
Yes, this offer, because it's a commercial facility, it's a restaurant, they are exempt from permitting requirements, but they're not exempt from public nuisance. And so part of our inspections involve seeing if the smoke.
I would like for you to report back to the board in November on this item.
Okay, sure.
Give me an update.
Great. Thank you very much.
And if I know it's probably a long way for you to drive, so you can watch it on your computer.
Okay, great.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Oh,
Yes.
Mr. Chair, I was just curious regarding wood-burning ovens, because years ago we had one. We owned an Italian restaurant in La Cienega. I thought we had to go through a process with AKMD. So we don't have any control for the installation at the time they're installing, so we can check that it's properly installed according to specs. So this sounds like a problem. There was an improper installation or something when it first went in. And
yeah, so what we, again, our rules exempt them from permitting requirements, but they don't exempt them from visible emissions. And so our job is to ensure that their emissions do not exceed 20% opacity. The video that was sent kind of showed that it appeared thicker, but what our staff is required to do is through the positioning, we have to put the sun behind our back, and there's a series of things that we go through, which the smoke isn't, we've determined that the smoke wasn't in excess of our rules. But what we're doing is we're stepping up our surveillance, we're out there more frequently, and we're gonna continue to monitor the situation. I'm sorry? Yes, sir.
Who would like to speak who hasn't spoken? Seeing no
Mr.
one.
Chair? Mr. Chair, yeah. This is the clerk. You had a card from a Gene Lee on this public comment period as well?
I called the name.
Gene Lee's not here anymore.
Okay. He left.
So we will then move to closed session.
It is necessary for the board to recess to closed session pursuant to Government Code Sections 54956.9A and 54956.9D1. To confer with its counsel regarding pending litigation which has been initiated formally and to which the South Coast AQMD is a party. The actions are in the matter of SCAQMD v. Aircraft Heat Treating Company and Aniplex Corp., South Coast AQMD Hearing Board Case Number 6066-1, order for abatement. SCAQMD v. Aniplex, Los Angeles Superior Court Case Number BC608322, Paramount Hexavalent Chromium, People of the State of California, XREL SCAQMD, BXI Technologies, Los Angeles Superior Court Case Number BC533528, INRI XI Technologies, U.S. Bankruptcy Court District of Delaware Case Number 13-11482, KJC Bankruptcy Case, Delaware District Court, Case Number 19-00891, Appellate Case, in the matter of SCAQMD versus Southern California Gas Company, Aliso Canyon Storage Facilities, South Coast AQMD Hearing Board, Case Number 137-76, Order for Abatement, People of the State of California, XREL SCAQMD v. Southern California Gas Company, Los Angeles Superior Court, Case Number BC608322, Judicial Council Coordinated Proceeding Number 4861, SCAQMD v. City of Moreno Valley et al. Riverside County Superior Court Case Numbers RIC1511213 and RIC1601988, World Logistics Center, Center for Community Action and Environmental Justice et al. v. City of Moreno Valley et al., California Court of Appeal, 4th District, Division 2, Case Number EO67200, Albert Palak et al. Versus City of Moreno Valley et al., California Court of Appeal, 4th District, Division 2, Case Number EO71184, Cal Portland Company versus South Coast Air Quality Management District, Governing Board of the South Coast AQMD, and Wayne Nastri, Executive Officer, in DOES 1-100, San Bernardino County Superior Court, Case Number CIVD-19258941, and Climate Industries, Inc., DBA Howard Industries, a California corporation versus South Coast Air Quality Management District, Hearing Board of South Coast Air Quality Management District in DOES 1-50, inclusive Los Angeles County Superior Court case number 19-STCP-04167. Conference with legal counsel initiating litigation. It is also necessary for the board to recess to closed session pursuant to Government Code Section 54956.9A and 54956.9D4 to consider initiation of litigation. One case, seek leave to intervene in California et al. V. Chow et al. USDC, District of California, in number 119CV-02826, challenge to the NHTSA regulation preempting CARB's EEV rules. It is also necessary to recess to closed session pursuant to Government Code Section 54957.6 to confer with labor negotiators, agency designated representative A. John Olvera, employee organizations, Teamsters Local 911, and South Coast AQMD Professional Employees Association, and unrepresented employees, designated deputies, and management confidential employees.
It looks fine. A report of the reportable actions taken in closed session will be provided to the clerk of the board. The meeting is adjourned. Thank you.